Hello everybody and welcome to round one of the Sim Racing Online Formula Le Mans Championship. We're live here from BRNL. I'm Liam Jenkins and we'll be your resident commentator for this hour and a half race. And alongside me in the commentary box today is George Talbot. I actually got that right this race. So this is shaping up to be quite a good race. As I said, you know, very quick races in there. So have you picked a winner yet, George? Or, you know, it's how critical is it to try and get a win here today?
Well, obviously, it's the start of the championship, so everyone wants to start off with a bang. So I think my money today is on practice. It looks like Casper Mortensen from Atlantic Racing Team seems to be the fastest one out there. So I think he will grab the win today. Looks like he's set for pole position as well at the moment.
Yeah, so it's really shaping up to be a good season. Of course, I mean, the more good starts you get towards the start of the season, the less work you have to do towards the end of the season, and that of course will alleviate some pressure. I mean, you can just maybe sit back or not feel as condoned to try and get the best finishes you can, and that really can help your mentality going towards the end of the season. So every driver will be looking to try and start off the season the best possible way and avoid incidents. It's an hour and a half, so you don't want to go throwing anything away too early.
Yep, definitely a long race strategy, very important today. I think they need just over a tank. But a lot of the drive saying that carrying the extra fuel is costing too much time, so I think we'll see them take about 45 to 50 litres and then stop and then change the tyres as well, then do another 45 to 50 litres.
Yeah, I mean, we saw definitely car factor race that there was a lot of strategy involved, and that could potentially make or break races today.
Yeah, definitely. It's going to be a busy time in the pits, definitely at the half race distance, so whoever has the best strategy will win today, because everyone looks like they're doing pretty similar times.
And it's still Mortensen that's actually still got pole position at the moment, so he's looking pretty comfortable out front. And of course, just behind him is Mohamed Patel for 25 Motorsport, so, you know, one of the Formula Sim Racing guys who kind of know his driving style, so it'll be very nice to see how he gets on. And there's another guy, of course, from FSR, being Tim Brook, still driving for 05 Motorsport. He's currently in 6th position. Peter Enders, who was very, very competitive up in the car factor last week for Atlantic Racing Team, and his teammate Mortensen is on pole. So Atlantic Racing looking pretty dominant. 3 of their cars are in the top 5.
Yep, strong performance so far for them. The top 2 are actually teaming up today, and the other second Atlanta Racing Team is Jose Mora and Jordan Weeks. But a nice grid today. I think we've got about 20-21 drivers. So, yeah, it should be a good start to the season.
Yep, so we've got 4 minutes left to qualify then, and then we will get this race underway. So it'll be an hour and a half stint, as we've previously stated. But, I mean, honestly, you don't really appreciate how long an hour and a half is. I mean, for these drivers, it really can be quite a trek around to just try and keep your nerve. You've got to be 100% focus. There's no gap, there's sort of a leeway, and coming off the back of the 20 hours of Nordschleife, you know, just commentating on that for a bit the other night, that you see some of the toll it has on the drivers after they get into their stints, and, you know, just a slight lapse of concentration can end your race, and especially it's so putting you down if it's like an hour into the race, and you just don't want to lose that kind of position so late on. And it's so just honestly about keeping your head and trying to bring the car home.
Well, not long to go, but 3 minutes and 10 seconds for the drivers to get their fast lap. In qualifying, not too important here. Obviously, it does give you the psychological edge. But with it being a double file, manual rolling start, the driver's going to be so close anyway, and they're going to get such a big toe with these prototypes. So turn 1 and turn 2 are going to be very, very interesting. I think I've set the server up right today, so we shouldn't have the issues that we had last time with the broadcaster thinking that the race started 3 times.
Yeah, but I mean, obviously you want to get the best possible start, and going into turn 1 you have to have that kind of mentality and play out all the different scenarios in your head. I mean, for me it's bad enough trying to drive 1 lap alone with no other cars on the circuit, but going into turn 1 knowing you'll be surrounded, you know, possible 4 other cars around you, having to brake and not only make sure you avoid contact but don't cause other collisions as well, can be quite daunting. So it's all about just trying to get in the zone and make sure you know what line you're going to take going into turn 1.
Yep, definitely.
So we're taking a ride on board then with the Englishman, Mohamed Patel, who's looking quite strong at the moment, currently second, and he's not too far away from the leader actually, he's only 0.4 but of course in the race if he loses that a lap, then Mortensen's going to have quite a hefty lead after a few first few laps.
Yeah, I think it, like I mentioned earlier, with the start, with everyone being so close together, I think the leader might find it difficult. If Mohammed or Peter or Tim can stay in the tow, they should be able to hold on to the leader. But if Casper really, really pushes hard and manages to break the tow, then that's his chance to get away. Otherwise, we could see quite a large train of cars at the front.
So it is taking a hit then right of all four, the last final after the session for Mohammed Patel into turn one, lightly lifting off the throttle, dragging a bit wider out of the apex, not hugging it quite tidy, but still gets quite a nice slingshot in towards turn two, keeping the apex very nicely. This will be a prime slipstream and opportunity in just a few minutes time to make an overtaking move. It's a long left hander, so you want to try and get the inside line to then launch the car in towards the quick snappy right hander, and of course that will be vital during the race if he's looking to make an overtaking move. Bit of a quick share from Patel, but nothing too major, only tail onto it quite nicely. So in towards the right hander again, kisses the apex very nicely. That's very cleanly done, very little fight or resistance in the car as he starts to just glide it over the curbs. And we saw yesterday in the Nordschleife race that a lot of the guys were actually almost wrestling the cars around, and that's one thing that you want to try and avoid doing. You want to try and be at one with the car and let it respond to every single move you make, because otherwise you will find yourself potentially in a pit barrier.
Yeah, definitely. With these cars you want to have a very smooth turn, and you don't want to heat up the tyres with these because they're overheating very quickly, and drivers have found that they have to run a lower wing to get the car to turn in nicely. But on the exit, especially at the slower corners, you'll see them fighting a little bit, trying to keep the back end intact. I think we're going to see a few spinners today, as they really struggle for traction. Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how low they're willing to put that rear wing.
Yeah, especially as you get towards the end of that stint as well, and they're going towards the pits, those tyres are going to get not only worn as well, but they're going to get especially overheated, so you will start to see the drivers lose grip. And oh, big drift, then Patel spun, and that's what we were talking about, just trying to pull on the throttle too early, and because of that just had no traction there, and there was nothing they could do except simply drift around the final corner and then do a 360. So that's ending his qualifying session in not the best way he wanted it to, but we will go to the race now very shortly.
Yep, just a 5 minute warm up today. The drivers will get their final briefing about the start and a few other rules, and then we should be ready to go. I think we've still got Tim Brook out there. Looks like he's smoking away with a low radiator and quali trim. And let's see if he can improve on his time.
So this is literally a last chance saloon, and he's currently P4. Could he perhaps get himself onto the front of the grid? Only time will tell, as the A5 Motorsports driver is actually a bit slower. Big twitch there by Tim Brook, and that's exactly what you're talking about, George. There isn't just any traction, and Brook has abandoned the lap to end the qualifying session.
I don't think... we've still got Scheller Stenbeck for Formula 05 Motorsport. He's out on the lap as he heads towards the final corner. See what he could do. I don't know that... we haven't got the timing up. So, not sure he should be on a lap. We'll see if he improves. Oh no, he's gone to start a lap, but he missed the timer, so no time there for Scheller. I believe that's it. I can't see anyone else out on track. So I think you can give a rundown of the grid.
So then your pole sitter for today's race in round one, so he's going to be holding his head high, is Casper Mortensen, and he's closely followed by Mohammed Patel in the 25 Motorsport car. And but he's found himself on a bit of a sandwich. Peter Enders, Mortensen's teammate, is your P3 man, and alongside him on the second row is Tim Brook. And then just behind him you've got Anders Nilsson, who was looking pretty feisty again in the FA5 Motorsport, and then Jose Mora in the P6. He's followed by Luke Walsh, Stenbeck, Sobolowski, Andreas Eriksson, of course, who was very dominant in the car factor race. David Alexis is 11th, Matt Strand is in 12th, Dalaran is in P P13 for the Mii Racing team. So on towards the lower end of the field, Dan, and it's Jordan
Weeks.
Jordan Weeks. Yeah, just our screen a bit. Other than that, so Jordan Weeks is P14, followed by Nick Phillips in 15, and then next
Eddie Halgren is 15th.
He's followed by Timo Toika, Oliver Brandt, Nathan Robinson, and David Nichols, who round out your grid. So a field of 19 cars for this race end, so not too chocker, which some drivers will be happy about and some won't be, but we'll all see how it pans out very shortly. So now down to a 4-minute warm-up, and then the race will get underway.
Yep, so drivers just getting their final race briefing notes here. I think Luke Walsh is in control today, and series admin. So, yep, we'll just await the 3 minutes 50 to go in this warm-up, and we should be ready to go and race. Well, it appears that I'm going to have to do the race briefing, so if there's a few minutes of silence, I apologise, but I've got to do some typing. Okay, well, I've given the drivers their final notes. It will be a manual rolling double file bar today, so when the lights go out, the formation lap will begin, so the leader will lead them around the circuit at no more than 130 kilometers an hour. They'll bunch up through the last corner, and we'll see them go double file, and they will continue at about 130 kph up until the start line. And then we will see the leader put the hammer down. There shouldn't be any overtaking before the line. It should keep them quite nicely bunched up for turn one. Hopefully we don't have any big crashes into turn one or turn two. So just over a minute to go before we head into race. Got a few drivers running with custom liveries today, as we can see the Atlantic car. Also got the 25 motorsport cars, Mohammed Patel practices pit stop. It'll be crucial today, as we've mentioned. You want to spend as little time in the pits as possible, but they're going to have to do a slightly longer stop because they don't want to carry all the fuel in the tank. So I think we'll see fuel and tyres being changed roughly halfway through the race, a 45 minute stint. As you can see, there's the Hope 5 Motorsport car behind him. We've also got Peter Enders in his Atlantic car.
Alright, so coming towards the end of the warm-up now then, just 20 seconds left until the race gets underway. And then, I mean, the drivers would have used this warm-up to perhaps learn the other drivers' driving style, to know to see how they approach the corners, especially in these cars, they can be quite unpredictable. You see a car in the wall there, a Stenbeck goes past. So learning how the drivers will, because, you know, I mean, you can race with a driver in 10 different leagues, on the same track, in every single different league, they would take the corner differently depending on the car. So it's very important for the drivers to know just how their opponents, who, especially the ones who start near them, will approach certain corners and overtaking spots. So there is your pole for this event as we get ready to go green flag racing then.
Yep, drivers will now be getting their final warning and final message to move onto the grid any second now. You can see the qualifying times up there on the screen at the moment. Fingers crossed that everyone got the message that it was a formation lap controlled by the leader. Looks like it though. Doesn't seem to be taking off too quickly. As we can see, a nice field.
Yep, so this is the very last opportunity to warm the tyres and the brakes. I mean, the last thing you want to do is start the race with cold tyres. I mean, these cars are very hard to handle alone, so you want the best you know, car setting as you get them. So you will see cars who saw the track and maybe sometimes a little bit more as they drift outwards, and perhaps maybe try and even avoid opponents who are lapping a bit slower than them on the warm-up lap. We've seen that in the past. I mean, what would you do if you were in Mahmoud Patel's position, as you see a car go wide there, which is exactly what we were on about, and that's not going to help pit start at all. But Mahmoud Patel, you know, starts second on the grid, and you know, he wants to try and leapfrog and get his pass more often as soon as he can. So would he try and move into turn one, or do they just on a slipstream?
Knowing Hamid, I think he's going to be straight fighting from the start. He's not a very relaxed defensive driver, so yeah, I think he'll be in full attack mode. But I think Peter Enders, who's in third, will also be looking to try and provide his teammate with a bit of support. So if he can jump Hamid into turn one, he is going to have the inside line. Mohammed's going to be on the outside. So, yeah, if the two Atlantic guys get to the front, then I think we will see Casper disappear.
Yeah, so all this will become apparent as they approach the start-finish straight. So this is it then. 1 hour, 30 minutes of racing is about to go green flag. It's a matter of seconds now then. The yep. Heartbeats will start to go pumping.
Yep, they're just heading up towards actually into the final sector, because there are so many similar corners here, it can be sometimes quite confusing. I think they're heading up Horsepower Hill now, as they call it in MotoGP, and then it'll be one chicane here, then another chicane, I believe. Yep, as they head up another hill. Well, this one could be Horsepower Hill, I can't remember, it's too confusing. But they're heading up now to the final chicane, and then we'll see them really, really bunch up, hopefully. And then we'll see them approach the start line, and then the leader will put the hammer down.
So onto the start line straight they come then. Mortensen straight on the power, looking to pull alongside as soon as he possibly can, and we are green flag at VRNO as Patel's on straight down the outside. You can see he's looking for a move. He's going to have to sweep it round, but Mortensen does a good job holding the inside line. He's got to be careful though, Patel. That other Atlantic car doesn't come through. Patel then round the outside of turn two. He can't quite make it stick, and as we said, George, he is looking particularly feisty right now, trying to make that move as soon as possible. He's again side by side with him round into turn four. It looks like the rest of the field's okay, but again Patel got the inside line now. Has he taken a leap? Yes, he has. Fantastic stuff there by the Englishman, and into the lead goes Mohammed Patel. Let's see if he can hold it then. It's going to be quite close. He's got two charging Atlantic Motorsport cars just behind him. Your pole sitter Mortensen being one of them, as the field all charged through, seemingly unscathed somehow. Bit of a drift there by one of them, but nothing too major.
Yeah, great start there for Mohammed Patel, as we guessed. Very aggressive. It looked like he picked up the toe and did an excellent move, set himself up well for that long chicane and got the inside line for the second part of it. But can he hold him off now as they head into the faster sector 3?
yet, and I'm able to tell it's not going to be like in the sight behind him. He's got a trio of Atlantic Motorsport cars all trying to jump on him. As soon as one gets in front of him, that's it, and they will just let the others get away, and that's not what Mohamed Patel wants. He needs to hold this lead if he can, and he's doing a good job. They can't let Mortensen get too much of a slipstream there as they go in towards the chicane, and Patel's done a good job so far.
Yeah, excellent driving from Mohamed. No mistakes so far, but he's got a long, long way to go. 1 hour, 25 minutes. Looks like he's going a bit defensive now. Makes a bit more of a defensive line into the corner. Oh, it looks like Casper's off. Don't think he hit the wall. He's managed to keep it out the wall. But that is, or is that Peter Enders?
It's a disaster then. Or one of the Adrian Motorsport cars. I'm not sure if it was that, but there's another car just behind. Yeah, so it is Mortensen then. So your pole sits down to P14. And that is a disastrous start. But back at the front, Patel still leads, and he still can't quite shake the Atlantic Motorsports cars. They're all going for a look. They all want a bit of Mohamed Patel, and he can't quite get it. Patel takes the inside line, but he loses one position. He's about to lose two if he's not careful. Oh, bit of contact. Patel goes a bit wide, but somehow manages to fight them off, but he's down to third. And it's Atlantic Motorsport out front at the moment. Tim Brooke just behind. These guys know each other well. From Formula Sim Racing, Brooke round the outside then, and Patel defends it sweetly.
Yep, I didn't realise that there was a second Atlantic Racing car as well there. Even though Casper Mortensen went off, he was replaced by Jose Mora, I believe. I believe Peter Enders as well. Great move. Both seem to get one hell of a slipstream. That's what I was talking about at the start. These cars give good toes, so we're seeing that train effect at the moment. No one can break it. As we see, look how close everyone is.
Yeah, it's all going extremely well right at the moment, though, for the Atlantic Motorsport team. However, if Mortensen can carve his way back through the field, as you said about this whole train system, Mortensen could find it quite difficult to try and pull his way back through.
Well, it looks like I believe that is Peter Enders at the front. Looks like the two Atlantic cars have managed to pull away a bit of a gap as Mohamed looks to be defending from his sister team, teammate Tim Brooke, in the 05 cars. It's 05 versus 25. But yeah, those Atlantic cars at the front definitely got a bit of a gap. This is not good. Mohamed needs to grab this toe right now and close this gap as Peter Enders sets the fastest lap at 151 dead.
The thing is, though, while being chased down, it's very hard to actually try and capitalise the slipstream because you're just losing all that air. You're just going straight over to your car onto Tim Brooks, and you're just going to start to lose a bit of time in to the duo out front. So Patel then starting to form his own trio just behind him then, of Tim Brooke. Of course, I mean, these two are quite teammates as well, so they're not going to want to try and take each other out. That'll be their last thing on the mind.
Looks like, I believe that's Anders Nielsen as well, just behind Tim Brooke, so he's going to try and capitalise on anything if the two in front of him have an accident. All these three teams actually all linked to the 05 Motorsport. We've got 05, 25 and Formula 05 Motorsport all in three different colours today. Tim Brooke all over the back of Mohamed, can't get the job done yet. Don't know if they're running the same wings. But looks like Mohamed's doing a good job so far, but if Tim is the faster man, Mohamed might need to let him through, and they might be able to work together to catch the top two again. We watch the field come through.
Yeah, so quite a few position changes at the moment then, as you see Mortensen way back down to where he is at prime position with E, but he's going to have to work for still an hour and 22 minutes, so it's still very much all play for. This race is nowhere near set in stone, but right now Mohamed Patel is only 0.3 seconds clear of Tim Brooke. He's still trying to find a way past, but doesn't quite have the momentum as they go over the hill.
Yep, Tim Brooke so close, inches behind the back of that 25M car. Can he get a good run out this last corner? Oh, Mohamed a little bit squirmish under throttle there as he put up into fourth gear. Surely Tim's going to get the run. Will Mohamed go defensive? Looks like he's giving Tim the inside line, but Tim thinks better of it.
Yeah, I mean, maybe echoes of qualifying Ellen for Mohamed after his incident right at the end of the session. You don't want to try and make that again, so you try and maybe take it a bit more carefully than you did it before. So right now Tim Brooks kind of knows that. He doesn't want to try and pressure his teammate too much and force him into an accident.
Meanwhile, back at the front, Peter Enders still leads, but he hasn't been able to break off Jose Mora. who's right behind him. Slightly different paint scheme for the second Atlantic Racing team. But yeah, only 0.2 seconds between them.
Yeah, so it's looking like they're very much in control of this at the moment then, as they start to pull away from Vettel and company. It's going to try and keep their head, keep it under control, maybe work out a pit strategy so they don't kind of conflict each other, because that'll be absolutely disastrous right now. They just need to work together, maybe give each other slipstreams every now and again, or give his teammate a boost out of the final corner perhaps. So all these things are taken into account when trying to set good lap times and pull away from the cars behind.
Yep, definitely. Doesn't look like that gap's increased too much, but there's definitely now a gap between Mohamed Vettel and one of the ME racing cars. Not quite sure who, if that was Magnus already driving that. But a few gaps appearing in the field now, I think, as we may have missed a few spins or incidents as we were following the battle at the front.
So,
to
quickly take a look down the field, see if there's any other battles going on. You see there's the two teammates of Ericsson trying to pull away from his teammate.
I believe Ericsson's actually an independent today, but Luke Walsh's teammate couldn't make it today, Taylor. He's got a few things he needs to deal with, but Luke is representing Sim Racing Online today, and he's in the car just behind Andreas Ericsson.
So there still is, all the, you know, there's still a train of, there is actually quite a huge chunk of gap between the cars at front and the cars at back now, and it's evident to see which cars are looking for a good position and which ones aren't, but of course, incidents, pit strategies, will all come into effect. We're still, they haven't even started this race, just 10 minutes in fact.
Yep, definitely, so much action already. I wonder if we'll be treated to a complete race of this. So far it looks like everyone's same pace as
Tim
Brooks. Looks like he's going to keep it out forward. Oh, good job there of not going across the racing line. So lost it quite a few places there, but he should be fine to continue.
It's a good save, but that's not the way he went to go, so around there went Tim Brooke, and he's now dropped right down the order, and if I'm not mistaken, I think he's behind Mortensen.
Yeah, you very well, you could be right there.
So we're just looking at the standings now then, so Enders is your leader, followed by Mora, Patel third. Yep, so it's indeed then Mortensen, as we're inside in front of Tim Brooke, and I think there could be a little smile on the face of Mortensen after that one. He's put himself another position effectively for free, and in front of quite a feisty racer as well, so that could avoid him having to do a spectacular kind of pass later on during the race.
Just seeing our leader now slightly out of shape there. Is this going to be Jose Mora's chance? It looks like he's got a good run out of the corner as they head up the hill to the next chicane. What can Jose Mora do as they're side by side? Peter Enders still just in front. Oh! Looks like he's given the place away, so we have a new leader of the race for Atlantic Racing Team 2, Jose Mora.
So it's on a good strategy there, you don't want to come together, so very well played by Enders. Although you can see, yeah, the gaps in the field straight away, the midfield from the rear field to, of course, the front of the field as well, is actually quite a big gap. You see Tim Brooks losing quite a hunk of time to Mortensen.
Watch Mortensen now, he's up to 8th on his comeback, his next. A man who used to get past is Luke Walsh, and then he'll have Andreas Ericsson.
Tim Brooke just behind then, looking for a move to go out to P9, that is, and he can't quite make it through there, though he needs to try and hold that line, but no can do, he's still all over the back of him though.
Not sure if this is Tim Brooke or Richard Stobolewski, not 100% sure. See if we can get the name, that, yep, you're
yeah,
right,
Tim
this
Brooke.
Is Tim Brooke.
And he's of course chasing your P964 car. And he's still just trying to fight for a move. He's gone round the outside. It's literally bumper to bumper. Just almost giving him a push round this track. Brilliant stuff here. But Brooke needs to try and pull out of that and give himself a bit of room to move. But kind of let us off a bit through there. I think that would have been a bit of contact if he stayed at that distance away from him.
Yeah, definitely looks a lot quicker than Matt Strand. I believe that's who in front of him for Satellite Racing.
He needs to try and just get a slipstream now. How he's doing that, I don't think he's going to be close enough for a move. Bit of a lock-up, however, by Strand, and that has put Tim Brooke right back on the tail of him.
You can also see in front, we just said a few moments ago, Casper Mortensen right on the back of Luke Walsh. And he get the run now, he's right in his tail.
You'll need to look around the outside, it's a bit risky to be honest, he's going to have to sweep it. But he's still going for anywhere, and kind of thinks better of that one. That was a and silly move if he went for it, although he has got the outside line now. If he can cut back inside, this could be a very good move as they return onto the home straight. He's got a nice little run into turn one. He tries and forces his way down the outside. That's a nice drag race there. Louis Walsh not giving up any room. Mortensen's going to have to sweep it around the outside, and it's very well defended, almost. Bit of contact there, but nothing major, and it's very... Oh, and there goes Matt Strand. I think he's kept out of barriers.
Yep, I'm not sure if he made contact or not, but he looks like he's still running fine. Meanwhile, Casper side by side with Luke. Again, great respect being shown.
Oh yeah, it's very good respect, you say. I mean, these guys being inches away from each other without contact. Mortensen again up the inside, really giving Luke a run for his money. Walsh though, having none of it without a fight. If he wants to come past, he's going to have to go to hell and back for it, because Luke Walsh is on fire at the moment, but he's not going to hold that one though. Mortensen's still pushing, he's not letting up anything, and because of that, that's given him a two corner side by side move. Three guys are coming.
Oh, is that spun? Is that
And that could be Enders.
Either Enders or Jose Mora.
I think that's actually Jose Mora, if I'm not mistaken. I might be.
If we can get the number on the car, I'll be able to tell you that is the number.
Number three.
Yeah, it's Jordan Weeks, I believe. Yeah, but it should be Jordan Weeks if he's driving the right car, but we'll double check on that, we'll get the standings up for you. No, it looks like it could have been...
Yes, it was Nora then.
Yep, obviously driving the wrong car today. Yes, a mistake for Jose Mora then. So Peter Enders leads. Oh, it looks like Mohammed's caught up to the back of him. I wonder if we missed some contact maybe between the two Atlantic drivers.
Yeah,
Mohammed definitely closer.
Where's the orange car gone that of Luke Walsh, which was being contested for? Now it is. This is the battle going on then.
Yep, so the pass was made after we jumped back. So next up is Tim Brook.
Here's Tim Brook going to give Walsh another one for his money. Walsh is out. Pretty hard time defending at the moment. He's going to have to go through all that again while I'm still trying to catch Mortensen, who, has to be said, performed some very aggressive yet excellent driving to make the move. It was side by side for around four corners while trying to push his way past, but Luke Walsh wasn't having any of it. But I think kind of had to let bygones be Guy Johnson, kind of let it go. But Tim Brooks almost fancies to look up the inside there.
There we go, we got the camera in the end. Look back from Luke Walsh's some Racing Online livery car. What can Tim Brook do? Obviously, he'll be a bit frustrated as he was looking to be challenging for the lead earlier on and made that silly mistake. No damage though, car still in perfect order, still a good chance to fight for a podium, but we're going to need to see him get past Luke as soon as possible and try and move up the order with Casper.
Yep, so that'll be interesting to see as the race progresses. Still got 1 minute 15 left in this race at the moment, so still very much all to play for. As you see the train of cars come through, let's see if Tim Brooks can perhaps try for the move on. I think he's going to have enough momentum this time, but maybe as they go towards home straight towards the end of the lap. A bit wide there then goes Walsh, and that could give Tim Brooks a little bit of a tow as they come up towards the chicane. Oh, and he goes off, Tim Brooks off. And oh, it's the second time he's come off today. And things going from bad to bad for the 05 Motorsports. Oh, another loss nearly. So things are not going well then for Tim Brooks. And so he was up in the top five. He's now, and there's I think that was the replay there.
Yep, just watching a replay, kept it out of the wall, just lost it under braking. So even further back now, so it looks like Casper Mortensen, who is in 6th place, I believe. Yep, just set the fastest lap of the race, so he is flying at the moment. Also, good to note that Andreas Eriksson has worked his way up into the order, into the top five, started, I think, outside the top 10, if I remember rightly. He's fighting with one of the ME racing cars, looks like Magnus Dahlgren, new SRO member, with a nice-looking car there, driving with Eddie Halgren today. So far, good performance by him to be in fourth, and there's Nilsson in front of him in third.
Yeah, so he's really kind of proving himself here right now. But right now, he's going to try and hold off the car just behind him. And that could be, you know, hard. I mean, as you say, Ericsson's done a pretty good job to get himself up there. Let's see how far he can go. But right now, still at the front, it's still Peter Enders who leads on lap 9. And he's still only not too far away from Mohammed Patel, and Patel's got to be fancying his chances. That's what he said, he's nuts. Behind, he's got a bit of a trouble start. Patel being under pressure and have constant visions of Atlantic Motorsports, whether it be in front, behind, or even at the side of him. So he just wants to settle that and make sure it's permanent. Atlantic Motorsports is settling in just behind him, and to do that he's going to try and make a pass on your way to see the Peter Enders.
Oh, a bit of a lock on their mind,
and Patel manages to get a nice run up the hill, and he'll be a very happy man right now. Big mistake by Enders, there was no actual contact with the wall or going off track or anything, but it has cost him potential first place, and Patel goes a little bit wide there. You guys got to be careful as they come onto the back stretch for lap 10.
Yep, so once again we've seen the lead change. So far we've had four different leaders, I believe, with Mohammed Patel leading, and then it was Casper Mortensen, Peter Enders, Jose Mora, and that's back to Mohammed Patel. But can he get away? These two have broken the third place man, Anders Nilsson. We look at him now, definitely a way back, so whoever can break the gap, or if those two can stick together at the front, definitely they must be the favourites today. Who will have the better strategy? We will have to wait and see to the halfway point to see what everyone's doing. But it looked like there was a good battle back there in sixth place.
Oh, this is a big grab. This is from Casper Mortensen, desperate to try and get himself back in the thick of the action. And right now, he's achieving that goal. He's got himself involved in a three-way battle for P4. And if maybe they can catch Nilsson, not only a three-way, four-way battle for a podium position. So Mortensen all over the back of the car in front. He just needs to try and perhaps nail Ericsson in the back straight. I mean, this is delightful to watch. I mean, what, we're 20 minutes into this race and we've seen some fantastic racing already. So if round one's anything to go by, then I think this is going to be a very exciting championship to follow.
Yep, definitely. The drivers, I think, have enjoyed this kind of setup with the one class, and this is obviously a new model in the endurance mod and seems to be very popular. Not much you could do with the setup, only one set of tyres to choose from. I think the drivers are really enjoying this. It's proven to be popular formula to race in.
Yeah, so let's see what Mortensen can do. Then he was on the pole sitter, so, and he has set a couple of faster laps as well, so he has got the pace, but catching one thing faster is another, and that theory coming into play here as he tries to go for a look on Ericsson. Cheeky little look up the inside of your fourth place man there. Of course, the rookie, as you said, coming into the lead. So, nice to see what he can do, try and prove himself worth. But Morton then, up the inside, that's a very cheeky move. I don't think I saw that one coming. Into turn one, let's see if he can make it stick. And, and that was a bit cheeky there by Ericsson. So it kind of literally brush his nose and say, you're not coming through. But very well defended by Ericsson, but that could have got very nasty very quickly.
Yeah, I think Ericsson got caught out. Looks like he was attacking the back of Magnus Dahlgren in front of him, and then got a really bad exit onto the start-finish straight, and that allowed Casper to really close up. But I think with inches to spare, Andreas Ericsson closed the door into turn one.
Talking about exit, a bit of a lock up there from Ericsson, allowed Mortensen to get right on the back of that orange and silver Le Mans car, the prototype. So Mortensen needs to try and nail Ericsson as soon as possible, because right now it's being held up and the two cars in front are getting away, which is not a sight Mortensen wants to see for very much longer. He's desperately trying to find a way through and putting Ericsson under some notable pressure, and that's evident in the driving style. He seems to lock the brakes a bit more and making a few more mistakes. And look at the toe just got out to the back of him as they come onto the straight, and you see just the amount of gap now they have pulled out while Ericsson and Mortensen do battle. Again, Mortensen is trying to literally sneak his car at the inside and almost push Ericsson out wide without sort of like even being near him. So just try and give the impression that he's there, so Ericsson goes out wide and Mortensen can maybe slip one through, which is almost what he did last lap into turn one. But right now they climb the hill, and look at the traction he got there. Mortensen all over the back. And now as they climb the hill in towards the game they come, and it's a good move there. That was no at all. But he can't do it. Oh, and he spun!
There was definitely some contact there. We might be able to watch a replay.
So they come uphill then, and so Mortensen's gone for a move, and I think what he's done, he's just, Ericsson's just perhaps took it too deeply, and off the back end, so Mortensen's come in. Oh yeah, he's bumped the back of him, and I'm sure there'll be some discussion about that after the race.
Yeah, that one will probably looked like a bit of an unnecessary hit there from Casper.
Yep, so as we just figure it down the order then, see if there's any other fights going on at present. It is back at front, but still is your race leader from Peter Enderson. And this is actually probably been the only Atlantic Motorsports to not get involved in an incident so far.
I think that was one of the SRS guys going slowly there on the track. Didn't manage to catch who it was, but... Looks like Anders Nielsen, though, has caught up a little bit.
Yeah, you can tell Enders is actually struggling to try and find a way past the tower, and because of that, Enders is constantly losing time to Nielsen, so I think Nielsen can kind of catch on to this, and we could see Nielsen up there in a fight for the lead, which would be very interesting.
Well, here he is now in third place for Formula 05 Motorsport. Fourth place, Magnus Dahlgren for Hemi Racing. Fifth place is Walsh, but he's got Kasper Mortensen, I believe, all over the back of him. So they swap places again, I believe, after that contact between Kasper and Andreas Eriksson. So what happened to Kasper?
Look at that, though. That's Mortensen still looking for a look on Walsh for a top five position in the opposite side of turn one, and he's made that very nicely. And no. Right there from Luke Walsh. He's of course did battle before. Luke Walsh then trying to come back as Mortensen goes wide. Walsh has got the run and back into P4. P5 even then goes Ericsson. So it's quite a nice fight. As he said, these two have been dueling for quite some time now.
Yeah, we saw them driving side by side for quite a few corners earlier. Let's hope they can show the same respect, and we don't want to see what happened before with between Ericsson and Mortensen, with one of them running into the back of the other one. So I don't think Luke will be able to hold him up for the whole time, but I think so far he's done a good job. We'll see how long this will last for, but I am expecting Kasper to get through the next lap or two.
But Luke Walsh isn't looking up easy, as you can see. He's actually holding his line. There's no budge from him whatsoever. Completely focused on holding that position. I think that's throwing Mortensen off from the past. What we've seen, Mortensen's been able to sort of muscle his way through and almost bully his way past in some circumstances. Almost a bit of a bump there, getting as close as he possibly can to catch a toe. A drag race into the corner, and still Walsh defends it, trying to sweep round the outside. It's not going to be enough. Surely he's caught the apex nicely, but I think Mortensen's got this one. But he's got the inside line for the next corner.
Yeah, he's going to have the inside line for the chicane, but then that's going to give the inside line back to Kasper for the exit. It looks like Luke's got a good run out of that corner as they head up the hill. And he get the run to fight back. He should, if he stays close enough to this final corner, he should be able to have a go into turn one. Let's see what he can do. That didn't look like he got the exit that he needed. So I think that move is done and dusted, and Kasper Mortensen moves up to fifth place. But now Kasper's got some clear track to try and catch the back of Magnus Dahlgren. So it's about a second and a bit in between them.
Yeah, so Luke Walsh sort of faded off the back of Mortensen now then, but just behind we still got battle there with what looks like to be Matt Strand facing another Atlantic Motorsports car. That's going to be Jordan then, I believe?
Jordan Weeks.
Oh, Jordan Weeks, yeah. Sorry, that's my bad.
Yeah, that gap was, the previous sector was 1.4 seconds, and now it's down to just under 2/10, so Jordan obviously driving some nice lines. Oh, it's a contact
big
there,
contact.
He's run into the back of him. Let's see if we can get a replay
there
of that.
So, I think there's a bit of lack of concentration and spatial awareness. That's there by Weeks, and that's, and that's not the way that you want to come out overtaking. Surely that's going to be a pit stop for both of them.
Yep, very unnecessary move there by Jordan Weeks. I think Matt Strand won't be too happy about that at all. But Jordan completely lost his focus there and went for a gap that didn't even exist and got his braking all wrong. Doesn't look like Matt Strand's car is damaged as badly as...
Well, Ennis is back in the lead. Surrenders is actually back in the lead, so we've missed the move for the lead there. So that becomes our fifth lead change of the day.
I tried to get it on the replay, but obviously we've missed that. But yeah, so that the lead has changed again. They still haven't been able to break off Anders Nielsen. You can still see him there in the blue and yellow car, back of the picture. So, wonder what happened to Mahad. Let's see if we can get the last lap times up.
Yeah, so Stalin is his move then. Baez is after being held up for quite a while, and he's actually pulled out quite a bit of a gap now from Patel, so I think that was just a straight racing move.
Have a look through the field, see if we can find some action for you. I have here, I believe this is Eddie Hallgren and Shelle Simbeck. I believe it's a Swedish battle going on here. The driver's obviously from Sweden.
Well, Simbeck's obviously going to be wanting to come out on top here, but whether he will or no is another matter. That blue and yellow car is looking quite feisty behind them.
I believe we have been joined by someone prematurely who should be driving at the moment. Welcome to the broadcast studio, Richard Sobolewski. What has happened?
I had a quite good first lap. I went to make the move, well not make the move, but get the run on Mr. Nielsen up the hill. Got on the throttle a bit early, stuck it in the wall. Damage wasn't all too bad, but started overheating the tyre, so I went in and got it fixed. Came out about half a lap down, something like that. And then Jose Miura was battling with Mr. Brook. He made a dive bomb on Tim, hit the side of Tim, power slid across the track, realised that I was going to be able to get my lap back by passing him and cut me off, which took my nose off, so back into the pits again. And then the balance of the car was non-existent.
Would you say the incident you had with you'll say more avoidable, and do you think it will be investigated after the race?
I'm just going to have a look at it now. From the way it looked to me, he cut across my nose. But he seemed to get out of it without any damage, which was cool.
Yeah.
And I lost the front end, so yeah.
Oh, that's a bad way to start the season. Were you feeling confident today? At a positive
confident
finish?
After qualifying even. I was positive after the first lap. I think things were looking good, but it was even positive after I had the first spin. But then I got actually in a battle with Jose for position after he'd spun out of the lead, and I had a wee little wiggle on the left-right chicane at the top of the hill, which sort of got the car a bit unsettled, and there was no room for him and me to get through there with me trying to save the car, and so his car caught mine and put me into the wall the first time round. But yeah, I mean, other than that, it was a good run. And my wheel didn't break, which I guess is a plus point, you know?
That's, moving forward then with the new wheel, progress
yep.
made.
Yep. Don't know if you caught my crash at the end of the race, or the end of my race.
No, we didn't. Apologise.
Quite good. Yeah, well, I spun out of one of the turns and Timo Toika had just done the same thing and I clouted him. Ripped off my front wheels.
Not good.
Really, I should have been commentating, but hey.
Well, I wouldn't have minded driving today.
You'd have let me know what was going on there.
I didn't want to ruin your opportunity of a potential race victory.
Yeah, let's not get carried away.
Have you been impressed with Mahang Patel today? We're just watching him now. He has lost the lead, but he was leading a couple of times today. I'm only a second behind Peter Enders. But yeah, it's good to see Mohammed still running for once and not in the wall.
That's true. But see, I mean, we're only half an hour in, so give it another half an hour. He might get bored and pull the plug, so we'll see how it goes.
I have to wait and see. Do you think everyone will be doing the 45-minute stint and then coming in for another 45 to 50 litres and a fresh set of tyres, and we see someone crawling on the side of the track there?
I think that's the plan for everybody, but I think the battle to watch on screen right now is between Tim, Brook and Jose for 8th position. They've all had already had a couple of coming togethers, the pair of them. Hosey's done some pretty interesting dive bombs, so get spicy out there.
Yeah. We're watching them now. Looks like Jim's going to have to go defensive. That corner scares me a bit when I've seen those scenes, because people look like they think there's a gap down the inside, but there really isn't. Especially with the straight after that corner, absolutely no point in making a silly move down there.
A bit of a wiggle there.
Yeah, I think he's trying to put Tim off a bit by making
it. Oh, big wiggle there by Tim. So the car's going all over the place at the moment.
Yeah, I think he's just playing mind games with Tim by doing the little wiggle just before the braking zone to try and make it look like he's going to make the move.
Yeah, so Jose Mara, of course, was involved in the incident earlier. We hope we don't see that again as he goes for a move on Tim Brooks, trying to wiggle perhaps, put Tim off. If you said that Brooks has got his head in the right place and defends the inside line as they go through the chicane.
So 55 minutes to go, roughly 10 minutes until we're expecting the first round, or the only pit stop really for the drivers, but that's when we're expecting them in about 10 minutes. It looks like Casper Mortensen has caught up to the back of Magnus Dahlgren. So that gap that was over a couple of seconds is now down to literally a tenth of a second. Let's hope he doesn't do what he did to Andreas Eriksson. They're now in the technical middle second sector. Now head towards the third sector. A bit of a straight here, heading towards the third or fourth gear corner, depending if you prefer the lower end torque or the higher rev. On the exit, a bit safer to go with fourth gear on the exit because it doesn't seem to slide as much. Casper all over the back of Magnus here.
As we said though, Magnus Dahlgren, of course, in his debut race has actually been pretty impressive. He's up there in an impressive third position, so if he could hold that, then it could well be some, you know, team scouts and some new talent. As long as he can hold off P4, he's, carved his way through the field, he's done a pretty good job looking to try and get back up there to fight with Pascal and his teammate Peter Enders. Is he going to make a move into turn one? He's all over the back, hoping he doesn't get another bump, and I thought he was going to do it then and got a bit worried, but up the inside he goes. He seems to be favouring that spot, and I think that Dahlgren's going to be realising that, but he doesn't want to cut him off, and that's getting very close indeed, but very well held there by Dahlgren, as we said.
Yep, but he's just going to come under pressure again as they head up towards turn two. Doesn't look like he's close enough, so Magnus will live to fight another day in third place.
Well, how long will that day last? It's a question, because Mortensen, you can see in the driving style, he's just so desperate for a way past. He's looking at every possible sort of angle at every possible corner. It's really, really aggressive driving here by Casper Mortensen. And he can, well, I mean, so far he's driving the afternoon to try and get himself up and spinning out to try and get him back up in towards contention for a win. Still 50 minutes left as well. He's doing that very well.
Yep, they just went past a lapped car. I believe that might be David Nichols in the satellite racing car. Not 100% on that, but I think that's who I saw. Yep, Magnus doing a good job. We have seen some excellent defensive driving here today. No one changing their line in the braking zones. These cars look like they're good to race side by side with, as we've seen today. We just hope that we don't see a few more of the incidents earlier of people coming into the back of the car in front as they misjudge their braking time. These two look to be comfortable racing side by side with each other at the moment. We just update you on the standard. Peter Enders leads, second Mohammed Patel, third Magnus Dahlgren, fourth Casper Mortensen, Luke Walsh is in fifth. Matt Strandetic, Andreas Eriksson in 7th, Jose Mora recovering in 8th, 9th Tim Brook, 10th Shella Stenbeck, Oliver Brandt in 11th, Jordan Weeks 12th, Eddie Hallgren 13th, Anders Nilsson is in 14th, and I just missed who was in 15th. It goes too quick for me to keep up, but it looks like Casper's got the run here. Magnus going defensive, although he gives Casper the inside, but he can't brake late enough. Magnus holding the outside, so it'll be a good positioning for the second part of the chicane here.
he's really not pushing anyway, not kind of giving any sign that the pressure's there, but more than trying to change that as he looks up the inside, he's looking very, very aggressive indeed, but again, very well held by Dal Grant, and you know, he's looking like he's sort of a robot, he's just no emotion. Trying to budge her as Mortensen, we've seen in the past, almost bully his way past certain cars, but he's just not having any of it, and just saying, you know, oh, a bit of a twitch there.
And that's just held.
Very lucky. And I'm sure the heart will be pumping at least 10 times faster after that one. But right now, Mortensen will be smiling. Yeah, he knows he could be getting the job done here. That pressure would be perhaps starting to build up a little bit after that. And Dahlgren will be making sure he doesn't make another mistake. But look how close they are as Mortensen goes up the inside. He looks for a move. And he's got the inside line, bit of an outbreak there, and that's, I think it's a wise idea by Dahlgren not to fight for it, but he's got the inside line again, but I think Mortensen's got the, oh look at that, he's trying to sweep it around the outside, what a move!
Yeah, brilliant move there by Magnus Dahlgren, excellent driver, I don't think Kasper was expecting that.
And Kasper now finding up again by behind the rookie, Magnus Dahlgren, so Dahlgren is going to be the hot chat of this race I think right now, again, so forcing round the outside down into turn one. Mortensen's going to have his favoured inside line by the looks of things, catching as much of a slipstream as he can before he goes up the inside. So I think Dahlgren once again should have the advantage here. And
there looks like Kasper's, is he going to hold it?
Big save, no, he's lost it, there could be more. Oh, and now it's going to be disastrous for Mortensen now. And that's the last thing he wanted. He's got it going again with no contact, but has not done his tyres any favours at all. So let's see it from his point of view. Into turn one, and I don't think there was any contact. Oh, maybe a bit of a towards the back wheel, but
yeah, I think that's very much unnecessary there from Kasper, as he wasn't actually alongside. He had his nose next to Magnus, but you know, wasn't alongside to claim that he had the inside line. So when Magnus went in to turn in, Kasper really should have backed out of that move.
Yeah, now I think he's behind the two satellite cars, if I'm not mistaken.
Yep, that'll be Strand and Nichols. I believe Strand is that car in front. There it is. Yeah,
so
fifth place.
So again, then involved in the wars. And he's not going to be a very happy bunny sat in that car right now, but one man who will be happy is Dal Grant. I think he's fended off one of the most aggressive drivers I've seen in quite a while. But back at the front though, it's still Peter Enders who leads from Mohammed Patel, but right now Mortensen's still trying to push his way back through, and I think we could see an early stop for Mortensen here to get rid of those scrub tyres now, because they will have advanced degradation due to the sort of incident going on just a couple of corners ago. I mean, look how he's still tucked away trying to find a way whilst trying to. Peter Enders does the fastest lap of the race at 1 minute 50.054.
That's a very quick time there from Peter Enders. As we look, it looks like he's got a little bit of a lead, but it's, I wouldn't call that the cover was under a second, so Mohammed obviously matching his times very, very closely as we go back to this battle. Looks like Matt Strand is going to have some pressure now going down into turn one. Let's see if Kasper can make this a bit cleaner. Matt Strand, I think, a bit wise there and gives him the space, although Kasper's run a bit wide. He's gone across the curbs. It's going to give Matt Strand the run. He should take back the position cleanly as he does.
Oh, Matt Strand's almost had a bit of a lock up there, and Mortensen will be fancying his chances. He needs to try and get as far out the field as he can. But if he keeps, I think he's just going to find the balance between aggression and just bringing the car home, because right now he's just going all out aggression. It's not doing him any favours. Well, he's still trying to find a way past Strand, but Strand is actually looking quite handy in that car. Currently P5, with Ericsson just behind them in P7 after Mortensen had a bit of an incident with him.
Yep, well, we're coming up nearly to the halfway point, so we'll start to expect some drivers to be making their stop very shortly.
That's a bit of Mortensen trying to find a way through desperately, but what could be very interesting is if Ericsson can try and get his way back onto the back of Mortensen and see if there's any bit of blood between the two.
Yep, I'm sure Andreas will be pushing hard to try and make amends for of this race. It so far hasn't got the plan, not entirely his fault though.
And the things going the way they are, and Mortensen being held up, he's going to be fancying his chances. So standing at the moment, Enders leads from Mohamed Patel. Magnus Dahlgren is in third, but Patel is actually closing the gap right up to Enders. So we could see a sixth lead change, I believe, as Patel looks up the inside. And, well, he might try and hug the apex, but well defended, though, by your race leader. I think Patel's not going to be able to get a slipstream in towards the next corner. He's kind of gone right to the back of him during the breaking point, but it's not going to be enough for an overtaking move. Enders looks like he's having a bit too much apex on that one, though.
Yeah, Mohamed definitely got the better line to that one as we're watching him now. It looks like he might be a bit more comfortable on the tyres at this stage. Maybe Peter's used them a bit harder. Interesting to see if Peter quickly comes in now to make his pit stop to make sure he doesn't lose too much time. I think if Mohamed sees Peter go in, he'll probably go out and do one more lap before he pits, because he doesn't want to pit at the same time, because the pit stops will be very, very similar times.
Absolutely, and if it actually be critical, especially if they're running on the same lap, then I think things could get very tense, especially within pit releases as well. Patel's still trying to find a way through as Enders again took a little bit too much curb there, and Patel's got to run as he goes up the hill. Ducks at the inside, but I don't think it's going to grant him enough to make a move.
So neither of them pitting this time round, so they're going to go and do another lap.
Yeah, and I think pit stops will be getting closer. It will be interesting to see who actually will be the pit stop. So I think Nilsson's pitted in, he's now down to 13th, so not sure what's happened there, but he could well have pitted in.
Yeah, I believe that probably will be a pit stop. Let's see if we can go back. No, so maybe he may have pitted a few laps ago, so not entirely sure on that, but yeah, he's dropped way down, so I'm hoping that's a pit stop and not a mistake. So, will they be pitting this time round? Still nose to tail. We haven't had one clear leader in this race so far. No one has been able to get away. These two are the ones that haven't made mistakes yet. Peter Enders for Atlantic Racing Team and Mohamed Patel for 25 Motorsport. They're coming up to some traffic now. Not sure if that was Nilsson or Stenbeck in the Formula 05 car ahead of them.
So it's all about patience now for Mohamed Patel, just going to maybe try and wait and leapfrog him in the pit stop. So I think that's the best bet to do, to try and hold your ground as much as you can and stay on the tail of Peter Enders. Or maybe wait for him to make a mistake. You don't want to go risking it all. I mean, we're just over halfway into this race.
So as they come to the start-finish line now, neither of them going for the pit lane. Maybe they've changed their strategies.
And Patel still tucked up straight behind them, and you can see the difference in driving style, so between Patel and Mortensen, and evidently the Patel's one sort of got him into a good position, whereas Mortensen's actually dropped him back quite a lot. Of course, started pole position, two incidents, and he's now still currently battling for fourth, I believe. Patel's on the inside, and this is for the lead, but very well held again by Peter Enders, but Patel has got the outside line that very well covered and pushed wide there almost by Peter, and is really sort of almost saying bring it on, if you want to take it then let's go. And Patel is very ready, but Patel's a very patient driver, I think, in this race. I haven't seen him be so patient in other leagues, but he's just sort of biding his time and waiting for the opportune move as opposed to sort of risking it with everything.
Yeah, very sensible drive from Mohamed today, no mistakes that we've seen. And yeah, really, this race is very much undecided at this moment. I want to call a winner between these two. Both experienced drivers, very fast drivers. But yeah, traffic now could be an opportunity for Mohamed as Peter catches them very quickly. But will they make their stops this time?
Yep, so I mean, it will be interesting to see what sort of factor the traffic will play in this battle.
Yeah, they caught it very quickly. Definitely one of the Formula 05 cars in front of them, and both Formula 5 cars and an ME racing car, I believe, in front. So it's going to be Anders Nilsson, Eddie Halgren, and Gilles Stenbeck, I believe. So who will pit this time? Or will they go out again? Going for another lap.
It's all going to come down to who can manage their tyres the best, because every lap those tyres are going to slowly fade away. And I mean, you're going to see a lot more mistakes. The cars will start to slide out more. The back end will step out of the exit corners, and it will all be down to who can handle their car most under pressure as well. So right now, Enders is looking in the favoured spot, but Patel always seems to find at least one overtaking opportunity. A lap, he's gone for it again here. This is his favourite corner to do it. He's for a bit side by side. It's gone down. This goes wide, but big save by Peter Enders. But Patel's got into the lead. I think Patel has to give that one back and make sure he doesn't let the traffic through. Well played by Mohamed Patel to not play the position. But I think Enders is going to be a bit unhappy about that, and that's not going to help his tyres either.
Though I think Pete did acknowledge that gesture by Mohamed. He did flash him back to let him know, say thank you. So I hope there's no malice between the two drivers. Seen a little bit too much contact today between some of the drivers. Hopefully they calm down for round two. Hopefully these drivers remember now in their pit stops to untick the option to repair damage. Otherwise, their crews will be repairing damage that doesn't need to be repaired. It looks like Peter comes up on the first bit of traffic. I think that's Eddie Halgren, who does the good job of just staying out of the way of this battle.
Very well played there by Halgren. So Mortis is on the third then, so I'm guessing that Dahlgren's actually pitted in.
Yeah.
21 seconds off the lead then, so it's perhaps trying to get a bit of an advantage over P4 now. So Mortensen's actually got himself back up, way up the field, but I think it's quite a way up at the moment. Still yet to stop as well, so
The race leader going for the pits, fully committed there, locked up, and just about gets the car slowed down in time. Let's see what he does in the box then. And jump to Mohamed Patel, who's now taking the lead. This is where Mohamed needs to fly. He needs to do the lap of his life now to make sure he gets the jump. I think we're going to see him pit now within the next lap or two. No point in staying out and using old tyres. Wants to get the fresh rubber. Only 38 minutes to go, so it'll be a shorter stint. The second half of the race. So can he put together a decent lap now to get him the jump? It's going to be so, so close. Let's see if Enders is much further back as he's in the pits. It looks like he's got Mortensen, who's just coming in front of him. So Peter Enders will move back past 34.9 seconds, I believe that says. I apologise if it's wrong. I can't see the screen too well today, looking at the stream PC. He comes out the pit lane, so where is Mohamed Patel? Will he pit this lap? Currently leading for 25 Motorsport. Proudly wearing his favourite number on the side of the car, number 69 by special request.
Well, I think that if Patel needs to get this right and actually make the decision to pit in now, then it should be all good, but we're about to see whether that will pay off or no. As he approaches the chicane. Hopefully the traffic won't get hold of him, and Mohamed can just keep flat out without having to get past traffic, or if Enders actually comes out in traffic, that can actually be a really big factor.
Yeah, so we're going to see you now. Bet a little bit of money that Mohamed Patel will pit now. If he doesn't, I'll go and have a go at him. But yeah, I'm expecting him to come into the pits now. Let's see. Oh!
No, he doesn't.
Staying out. Controversial here. Maybe he thinks the tyres are fine, and maybe he's still delivering good lap times. Let me see if I can get the last lap last time round. I believe it's at a 150.3.
Yeah, so it's an extremely quick time then by Mohamed Patel, so obviously not being in the need to pit at this rate.
Where is Peter Enders? Let's look down the field. Second is currently Matt Strand. Third, I believe that is going to be Peter Enders. So that's the pace at the front too. Peter Enders, who was leading, made a pit stop, but he came out in third. That's how fast the two at the front were going.
Tim Brook is actually out of the race. We've missed that one. And you've got Alexis Robinson, Timo Toika, Robert Sibolowski, and then Tim Brook, and Oliver Brandt.
I tell you what, I don't like that name, Richard.
Oh, not again.
Yeah, it's too racist, and our apologies, Mr. Sobolewski. Your new name's Robert, and last time round it was George.
Oh, I've got such a way of making friends.
Here we go, Mohammed Patel still leading Slatan Pitted. He's coming up behind. I believe that's Nilsson in front of him. Let's see. Put the tags on. No, this is Stenbeck. So Shella Stenbeck in front. This isn't for position, this is just for to be lapped. So will Mohammed Pitt. Come on, make it easier for us.
Oh, he's actually picking up a slipstream. Very smart move there. Just if it's available, then go for it. If it'll pick you up perhaps the next thousandth of a second, then it's definitely worth a shot as they go through the chicane. He needs to be clinging onto the back of the lap car. Very smart manoeuvre there by Mohammed Patel. And he does indeed pit in, and it was a much cleaner entrance as opposed to Peter Enders. So let's see where Enders is in comparison.
Here we go. So Mohammed in the pits as we speak. We've got first place sitting in the pits. Matt Strand, who hasn't pitted yet, in second, so he may take the lead until he makes his stop. We've got Peter Enders here. Is it going to be enough, Mr. Patel? It looks like someone is connected to the server as we're doing the broadcast. Apologies for that. Is it going to be enough? It looks like he's quite far behind. I think Mohammed Patel is going to get this done.
He's worked hard for it, so he's very well deserved it if he can do, but Enders isn't going to go that far. I think this is going to be close. Patel's on his way out. And Enders is down the straight. This is, I think Patel's definitely got it done. And there is Enders way in the background. So, very job well done there. I have a couple. There's a bit of smoke. That's not what you're
expecting. Yeah, but I don't think he switched his engine off in the pits. And he's overheating a little bit. Hopefully he can nurse this now and try and get it cooled down as quickly as he can, and this doesn't blow. I've seen him blow his engine in this mod too many times. Let's hope he can sort this out.
It's looking a bit better now though, but if he has to ease off, it's not going to help him, and I think that Peter Enders is going to be feeling quite satisfied.
But yeah, great work there from Mohammed to stay out and do a few extra laps on those older tyres. Obviously he felt very comfortable on them and did some excellent times, and that really has showed us Peter Enders has lost a lot of time in between those pit stops. The third place is now Luke Walsh. I believe Matt Strand has pitted. That's dropped Mr. Strand way down the order as we try and find him. There he is in eighth. He was in second overall. A top 10 finish for him. Not too bad. Limited testing. He has quite a busy schedule, so good performance for him. See him up in eighth spot.
Yeah, he's further down the order then. If we can see if there's any other fights going on the track, maybe. And so this is quite close at the moment as we go through. So this could be a battle potentially for third place. You see Luke Walsh.
I believe this is for fifth place.
It's in a Mortensen again then. So two guys have a score to set, it looks like, as Ericsson now at the upper hand, and he's going to want to try and keep that and not have a repeat of last time.
Yep, well, we're got 32, just over 32 minutes to go of this race. Not expecting any more pit stops, so now this really is just a drag race to the finish. You know, they'll be very much comfortable now and fully aware of the surroundings and the drivers. They know who's on what kind of pace other people are. So it's just a matter now of focusing and bringing the car home in one piece. But obviously lots of battles still to settle. The lead for the race isn't over by any means. Only 3.4 seconds, I believe, between the front two. And obviously we're watching this battle now for fifth between Andreas Eriksson and Kasper Mortensen. I believe that is in fifth and sixth.
Yeah, so things are going to get pretty heated here, I can imagine, as Mortensen's going to perhaps think twice before thinking of a move on Eriksson.
I don't think Andreas will be too pleased to see that it's that car behind it.
And he's almost forced his way out the inside again. He's got the outside line, and the inside line for the next corner. But pretty well defended at the moment by Eriksson. He's not going to want to repeat it before, and he's defended that one pretty well. He doesn't outbreak himself and go wide. And he's got Mortensen literally tucked away behind him at the moment. So they come onto the straight, and it's Mortensen with the slipstream. He's literally about an inch away from the rear end of Raxton, looks up the inside, and he's too far away. Dog backs only one, goes around the outside there. That's a surprise to know why Mortensen obviously run out of road.
Right, that was a bit of a slide there from Andreas Eriksson to that corner, did well to hold on to it. He's going to have a lot of work on his hands if he thinks he's going to be able to hold off Casper for the next 30 minutes of this race. See if we've got any other battles going on the track. The USA Moore in 7th. I'm going to get my buttons to work. I believe this is going to be Jelle Stenbeck, I believe, in 9th. You see, yep, and his teammate Anders Nilsson in 10th, Eddie Hallgren in 11th, Jordan Weeks in 12th, and not quite sure who this is now. We can get some this will be David Nichols, I believe, yep, in the other satellite car, and followed by who's that there? Oliver Brandt has DNF, Tim Brooks are going to the DNF now, Tim Brooks as well, Nick Phillips, Richard Zobolewski, Tim Toika, and Nathan Robinson, David Alexis, obviously the first one to go of all of them. We go back to the front and see how Mohammed is doing, and the gap between him and second place man Peter Enders down to 2.8, so Peter closing the gap. This race definitely isn't over. Seen Peter Enders in many championships such as the RGLMS when under pressure, and when he needs to pull something out the bag, he normally can. He can go on some crazy runs and put lap after lap together. He needs that now, as he needs to close the gap to Mohammed.
You see him in the background, he's only 2.8 seconds away, and
the only thing is trying to hammer
away at that. So he really is trying to claw away and just dig at the leader, but so has Mohammed's going to see that and hopefully not start to panic, or we could see a very tense end to this race. Still half an hour remaining. We're well over halfway into this race now, in towards the final quarter, so let's see how long Purcell can hold his lead for, and if he can come out the winner of the first round of the Formula Le Mans Championship. So the gap up to 2.9 now, but back at this battle there, misses between Eriksson and Mortensen. Mortensen's got still tucked away behind Eriksson at the moment though, and he's not going to try and get a move there. Eriksson's not budging at all after earlier, and I think there's going to be some bitter taste in the air between them. A bit of a wiggle there by Eriksson, that could make Mortensen have a run at them. He's going up the hill now, trying to desperately find a way. He always favours the outside line there, but we've seen in the past that hasn't quite worked. Well, he has plants with a favoured line to get a slipstream out of the chicane onto the home straight then, and immediately goes up the inside. Eriksson trying not to give him room, but doesn't want to repeat of last time, and he's almost touching with her, forcing Mortensen in towards the other track, and he goes around the outside, and it's still side by side. Mortensen almost collect each other again, but very close racing here, and I think Eriksson's somehow going to hold this one off.
Yeah, great driving there again. Good respect to Andreas, really did well to hold on to the outside line. A little bit of wiggling there into the braking zone as we see this this relationship between these two drivers get ever hotter, as a bit of anger will probably be going on inside the head of Mr. Eriksson after the incident they had earlier. But let's see if Casper can make up for it, make a clean pass. Andreas looks like he's going to make it as difficult as possible for Casper to get this move done.
Absolutely, Mortensen not going to want to try and waste any more time. He's pointing out earlier on during the race. Luke Walsh, though, up into third position, so an impressive run by him, and he's followed by Dahlgren. And we've got Stenbeck 9th, Nilsson 10th, Holgren in 11th, and Jake Weeks is in 12th position at the moment. But all the focus is on this battle at the moment between Mortensen and Eriksson.
Really does look like Andreas is pushing as hard as he can. That car looks pretty lively through some of these corners, really drifting it through on the exit when he puts the power down.
Yeah, we just be careful, we don't lose the back end. We've just seen him do that twice, I think, now. So Mortensen just needs to try and or just tail, and I think every time you get to the straight you just sort of have echoes of the earlier stages in the race. Mortensen again trying to find that inside line through turn one. Is he going to find it then as Ericsson's pushed to the curb? And no thank you, as Ericsson, he wants to keep that position for as long as possible, but Mortensen's not going to want that to happen. He's still literally bumper to bumper the whole lap. Now he looks at the inside, that's a very good run. He can just get the braking point right. Not quite. Maybe next time. The time ticking slowly then. 25 minutes left of this first round. And Mortensen's gone. If he can get an extra position, he will. And he needs to try and get past as soon as possible. Still no luck as of yet though. Ericsson doing a fairly good job, the race winner from the kart factor the previous week. Mortensen leading, of course, the pole position. So both these guys know what it's like to be at the front of a field. So we'll see who comes out on front out of these two in just a short while. And look how close they are. That looks like one extended kart. Mortensen opens up towards the inside and has, oh, a very aggressive, almost like an air push there, is what I like to call it. But Mortensen seemingly has a position for now. Can Ericsson try and regain composure and get it back as they climb the hill? I thought he looked up the inside there, but thought better of it. So it's a well played by Mortensen, but again, a bit of an aggressive move.
I think given the performance of these cars and the grip that they have in the corners, it's... you have to be very, very late and quite difficult to pass in these. And often when you try and make the move, you have to leave enough space for the other driver, and because they've got so much grip mid-corner, they seem to be able to hold it around the outside. So that's why I think the drivers are finding it very difficult to make a pass and actually make the pass stick. But it looks like Kasper's done it now and is maybe starting to pull away a little bit. Let's go back to the leader, see how he's doing. Looks like he's got a bit of a... bit of a gap there now. If you watch Mohamed Patel itself, gone up to 3.6 seconds. Was it two and a half a few minutes ago? So he seems to be turning up the pressure a bit on Peter. So he's gonna, let's see if Peter can respond to this. But Peter Anderson in second. Third place is Luke Walsh for SRO Racing. Fourth place, Magnus Dahlgren for ME Racing. Fifth place is Kasper Mortensen for Atlantic Racing Team 1. Sixth place, Andreas Eriksson, he's an independent today. Seventh place is Jose Mora for Atlantic Racing Team 2. In eighth place we have Shelle Stenbeck for Formula 05 Motorsport. Ninth place is teammate Anders Nielsen, also for Formula 05 Motorsport. Tenth we have Jordan Weeks in Atlantic Racing Team 2. And in 11th, Eddie Halgren for ME Racing. And in 12th, we've got Matt Strands. That's DNF. We missed that one for the Satellite Racing. That's fairly recent because he's still ahead of his teammate, David Nichols, who's in 13th. I believe that could be the last of our runners. Yes, it is. Doesn't appear to be too many battles out on track at the moment. Oh, Mahad Patel looks like he's done had a bad sector there, because the gap is now back down to around 2.5 seconds, I believe.
And that's not really helping him too much, because as you said, Anders knows what it's like to try and push in. It's in the wall, and surely that's ending his race. He's got it stuck in the gravel.
Let's watch a replay of this. We called it earlier, and Richard in particular saying, let's see, a long way to go as he just gets on the throttle too early and hits the wall. Watch a replay now. He might overheat that engine. Looks like it's smoking as he's trying to get it out of the gravel. Disaster for Mohamed Patel. This is handed it on a plate for Peter Enders, who had issues last week at Daytona in the kart factor, blowing the engine with only minutes to spare. That's put Luke Walsh up into second. Great drive from him today. Magnus up into third. Mohamed Patel, what were you doing? And it looks like he has DNF'd. Oh dear, oh dear.
It's so unfortunate. What I'm going to do is maybe snag an interview with him.
I'll see if I can drag him up now. Mohammed, what happened?
Well, on that final lap that I was doing, I noticed my top speed was a lot less, and I've just checked. And the issue I had prior to the race with my low tail brake has happened, and, I've got over 50% of the brake on at the moment, and I'm not touching the pedal, so...
I think you need to get that fixed for next round. You had the win, it looked like you drived an excellent drive today, dealt with pressure, led for quite a lot of it, and seemed to be fighting nicely, and the strategy that you did to stay out a few extra laps and put in some decent times worked wonders for you, and sadly we're sat here talking to you with 20 minutes to go.
It's been a great race anyway. It's a shame that Casper made some errors whilst I guess he would have been in the distance, but Petter has done a great job. I think he was a bit faster than me before my incident. I think a couple of tenths faster, so it would have been tight even without the brake problem.
Well, unlucky, and it was an excellent drive up until that point. Sad that you had the technical issues and issues with your pedals. We hope you can get them fixed, and we look forward to seeing you at the next round and also next weekend at the Kart Factory at Road America. So very much unlucky, but an excellent drive today.
Okay, thank you, and thanks for the broadcast.
No problem. But it's important now we can let you know that we are very privileged today to be having Liam Jenkins doing our commentary, second week in a row. I hope he's enjoying it, and I hope he stays for more. We do thank him for giving his time today to help out with this broadcast.
Yeah, absolutely. It really is an honour and a privilege for me to try and comment. I mean, these races always seem to deliver recently. It's just been fantastic to see. And this man as well, on his debut, to find himself now up in a podium position, is going to be very happy, providing he can hold on for the next 20 minutes or so. I'm sure that a few teams will be eyeing up his performance and maybe thinking, but I mean, we've seen Mortensen do battle with Dahlgren before, so if we see recurrence of the past, then we're up for a very, very intense finish to the race.
Yeah, I'm just looking at the last lap times, and Casper Mortensen is still flying. I believe that is at a 50.3. Definitely catching him fast.
So things about to get even more hotter, as if the race wasn't all fired up already, as Mortensen, probably been the centre of attention all day in the race, has now got himself right up in just under a second away then from Dahlgren at the moment. So let's see what Magnus Dahlgren can do. So he's looking okay at the moment. Holding his line well. We saw earlier actually under pressure Mortensen's going to be noting his driving style again. He didn't actually crack very much. He was holding his ground all the time while Mortensen was desperately trying to find a move, but see how he can go now. Mortensen's looking like the faster car. 16 minutes left nearly, so you don't want to try and ruin it now right at the end. And look how close he's getting through there. Mortensen really does like to try and get up close and personal to those cars. It looks like he's taking out on a date as he now tries to all the way round. It's not going to quite find it through there.
Just seems to nail the exits of all the corners and straight in the draft. And let's see, he seems to enjoy attacking into turn one. So,
big switch out by Dahlgren, and very lucky for Mortensen to not go straight to the back of it. But he's now got a very, very nice run into turn one. I think Dahlgren's going to be defenceless there. Sorry to cut you off, George, but that's scary.
Right.
A very, very lucky escape there for both Dahlgren and Mortensen, because that was almost a race-ending incident right there.
Yep, just shows one small mistake just cost him a podium position there. So great recovery drive then from Casper Mortensen, who's now up to third. He was outside the top 10, I believe, earlier after his incidents. But he will be pleased. This is looking good for Atlantic Racing, who are currently first with Peter Enders, and third
in the race. Just the lone SRO racing driver today, Luke Walsh, going about his business quietly but doing an excellent job. Currently in second. I think he has got a decent gap back, so I don't think Casper Mortensen is going to catch Luke Walsh. Definitely quite a big gap between them, so Luke will just be looking to bring it home and make an excellent start to the series with a decent points haul on the board at round one.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, been sort of the unsung hero of this race. He's constantly been there in the top five after a few battles, and he really has just been consistent. He's just been lap after lap, and you've got Ericsson there in P5 at the moment after losing out to Mortensen and, of course, being involved in an incident at the start, but still bringing it home. Then you've got Jose Mora, of course, involved in a huge spin early on during the race, but still managing to bring it home inside a good point scoring position. And then you've got Swedish Sven Beck, who's again sort of unsung today. He's been pretty consistent and moving his way up the field.
Oh, I believe that was probably our last remaining battle currently on track. We look through to find some battles. So, I believe something happened to Mr. Mortensen. I believe he is now showing in 6th, as Jose Mora is in 5th, and Casper Mortensen is in 6th, so I believe we just missed that. So something is, or am I getting confused? No, because we saw him get past Andreas Eriksson a few laps ago, and now he is behind them. So something has definitely happened to Casper Mortensen. They were first and third in this race because he was fighting with Magnus Dahlgren.
That man
so
there, yeah.
So a mistake has taken place. We missed that. So Magnus Dahlgren being rewarded again. He should be able to drive it home and get the podium. So in fourth, that promotes Andreas Eriksson. Will he have to fight off the two Atlantic cars? I don't know how far behind they are. Let me see if I can get a shot here as he goes past. There he is, and then there's Jose Mora and Asper. Oh, I think he will have Smira's ball if Jose Mora allows Casper to go through, because he is the quicker of the two drivers.
Yep, so I mean, we've got 13 minutes left now, so just into the final stint of the race, and it's just, it really has been a fantastic opening round to the series. I'm sure, I mean, if you guys are excited as I am, then round two is going to be phenomenal if this is anything to go by. I mean, we've seen some of the closest racing, some thrill spills, and everything in between. It really has been great to watch. Bit of a twitch, that was a big one there. And that is Jose Mora, yeah, so he's got Mortensen behind. So Mortensen's actually fighting for a top five then, so it still isn't over till the checkered flag falls. And then you've got Ericsson just in front, so if Ericsson maybe makes a mistake, we could potentially see a three-way battle for four.
Yep, and then round three of the battle between Andreas Eriksson and then Casper Mortensen, them two have seen far too much of each other today.
But not long left now then, just coming up to the final 10 minutes. And I think this has actually been a great example of just, you know, oh, big side down, Mortensen again off the track, and he's seems to use a bit of every single centimetre of track there is today at the moment, actually.
Yeah, I think he's really pushing hard now, trying to make up too many mistakes. As I said, this man was the favourite, got pole position, led at the start, and then got involved in too many incidents. He's got to try and talk this out for round two if he wants to be classed as a serious title contender. It's going to be advantage Peter Enders, as Hamid Patel's got a DNF, so he won't be scoring many points today. His other rival, Casper, as we've seen, 6th place at the moment. I think he's going to be 5th or 4th at best if he pushes hard. Maybe 5th is more realistic. But yeah, so Peter Enders definitely going to be the big winner of today's opening round.
Yep, so we're coming towards the final 10 minutes, and let's just see how this ends. I mean, Enders has got quite a comfortable 13.5 second gap over P2, of Luke Walsh. So Luke Walsh, again, has been rewarded for his efforts of Mr. Consistent. So he's going to sell it to second place, which is, I think I'll be quite happy with that.
I think he's going to be very, very pleased with that series admin, as I mentioned earlier. Proudly driving in the SRO Racing colours today. Coming up to some lap traffic there, that's David Nichols in the satellite racing car. Yeah, I think Luke has obviously got to be up there for driver of the day. Definitely a nomination. But we'll come up with one by the end of the broadcast today. It looks like he's actually being caught a little bit. He might be taking it easy, but I think Magnus just took a bit of time out of Luke there, but Luke won't be too worried. He's got a 12-second gap and only 10 minutes to go, so he can afford to lose about half a second a lap.
The thing is, though, with Magnus at the moment, if he does seem to let off the power and relax a bit to bring the car, and you've got a very hungry Ericsson behind who's looking to make up for his spin earlier so and finish as high as possible, and I think if there was a mistake or he could get the move done, I'm pretty sure he wouldn't turn down a podium position.
Yep, definitely. I just realised how close Ericsson is to the back of Dahlgren, so that might be why Dahlgren is pushing so hard and catching Walsh as well, because Dahlgren wants this third spot. This would be a great recovery drive for Andreas Ericsson, who was punted earlier by Mortensen. So can Ericsson get the move done?
I'm about to find out. I mean, 9 minutes 55 seconds left in this race, and I've got a feeling it's going to come down to the very wire. It's either going to end in sweet harmony and everyone crossing the line in an orderly fashion, or it's going to end in with 1 minute to go and someone making a desperate move, and it's going to just ruin the race and it'll end in tears. But either way, we'll be here to the very end, and I'm pretty excited. We've got two battles going on, one for fifth place and one for third place, so this race is nowhere near from settled yet.
Looks like Casper Mortensen's got the job done. You'll say Moore is now sixth, so them two have swapped. And we can actually see if we ride on board, you can see, I believe, Andreas Ericsson and Magnus Dahlgren just up ahead. I think that's them just up ahead. So if he pushes like mad, who knows, we could see him fighting back up for a podium again, even with all the incidents that he's had today. He's pushing like mad, using every inch of the track that we've seen in the last 5 minutes of him going across the curb and using a little bit too much at times, but definitely pushing hard. Increasing the gap there by about 7/10 of a second over Jose Mora. So can he put in some really fast laps now and catch the battle for the final podium spot? It will be a three-way battle. We jump back now to the third place man, Magnus Dahlgren. Fourth place is Andreas Ericsson, as we mentioned. Look how close he is.
Again, extremely close, this is scarily close here.
And there you can see that's Mortensen right there as well, and Mora. So four drivers all within a few seconds of each other.
I mean, this kid can get very, very tense. You've got four cars, and if two of them make a mistake, then you can see this whole top six cars have been completely rearranged if someone just pulled the names in the hat and shuffled them. So it's nowhere near from finished yet. There's Dahlgren trying to find anything he can, any bit of extra speed around his track. He needs to try and dig out, he needs to dig down deep and make sure he brings his car home, because Ericsson is a very racing guy, very well experienced in this sim racing as well. Of course, the winner of the car factor last week. So he knows what it's like to get to the front of the field. He's going to need to prove that today. At least 0.5 seconds clear at the moment is Dahlgren. So it's the line of four, the line of standing there, and you've got, I think, perhaps Mortensen and some of his teammates to maybe ease off a bit because he's dropped back quite a lot. He's in nowhere near danger of losing his sixth position. So, we'll just have to see how it pans out, because right now, Dahlgren, you may see, there he is, Mortensen coming over the top of the hill.
Yep, so we're looking back for Magnus in third, here's the view back from Andreas in fourth, here's the view back from Mortensen in fifth, who really has disappeared from Jose Mora. So back to the third place man. Get him up on the screen right now. Here he is. Andreas was actually a lot closer on that last lap, but got a poor run in the second to last corner, I believe it was, and struggled for traction. That allowed Magnus to sort of have less pressure down straight, because Andreas wasn't close enough to have proper battle in. We've seen turn one is one of the more popular places to get the overtake down after getting the toe after the final corner. Looks like he should be close enough this time, just needs to stay and get a good exit onto the start-finish straight and he can get that pass done. He needs to get it done pretty much straight away, otherwise he's going to have some errors for Casper. Yep, and as you mentioned, traffic hit, this could be the opportunity.
He's going to be inside, and that one's not going to have none of it, and completely cut off the inside line supply route. But look how close Mortensen's getting. This is getting extremely tense now. Mortensen and Eriksson have been in the wars all day, and we hate to see another one of that, but of course that car getting out of the way very sensibly. I'd hate to deal with these three guys at the moment.
Yeah, both these drivers went very deep into the last corner. They wanted Andreas to stay tight so he could get the run out of the last corner, but they went so deep that look how close Casper Mortensen now is behind Andreas Eriksson. They just ended up both losing time as he goes to the inside line and Magnus shuts the door.
And look at Mortensen then, because Mortensen could have a look at the inside maybe. We know Mortensen's all about being the opportunist here as he just goes for moves, which it seems only he can see some of the time. So if there's a gap, I'm pretty sure you'll see that Atlantic Motorsports car go through it as soon as possible. And look how close he is now. This is going to get very tense. 5 minutes to go. Peter Enders looks like he could take the one as long as he keeps going. But you've got three cars battling for a podium position. And what about Benny? Oh, there's contact! And that's big, big contact for Eriksson. And I'm pretty sure he may have just touched Mortensen. And Mortensen's desperately trying to find a way through. Hopefully he won't have any damage. But Mortensen's being held up. And I'm pretty sure Dalvin, if he doesn't have damage, can pull out one heck of a lead now over these two guys. But it's not looking that way at the moment.
I'm not quite sure what cause that is. And they look like Andreas was tight and seemed to get good drive, and Magnus seemed to be quite slow off the corner, a strange incident, but yeah, definitely some contact between the third and the fourth place. And it doesn't look like there's any heavy damage, as Andreas has now gone from defense mode back into attack mode. He's sizing up the back of Magnus, although look at the run that Casper's got.
It is tense, and look at side-by-side, that one's not going to let go. And I think this could all end in tears as Eriksson goes off. Rejoins, and now Mortensen through. And we said about being opportunist, Eriksson drops back. Mortensen looking to turn one. He's got the inside line, 4 minutes left in the session. And I think Mortensen's going to clinch P3. Dahlgren not at any time of giving up, still clinging on to the rear end. I think Mortensen could possibly have this one wrapped up.
Yeah, as I mentioned before, the two drivers in front of him, I don't know what was going through their head. For just being so silly into the last corner, and both got off runs as Magnus is going for the inside.
Oh, he's on the roof! Multiple rolls! And that surely is the end of the race for Mortensen, and he will be extremely angry. I'm sure that he will have a few words to say to Dahlgren at the end of that. So the heroic drive from Dahlgren has just slowly poured away. They'll take a replay of this, and just a slight touch, and then from there on, carnage unfolded. I'm not sure whose fault that was. Probably Dahlgren's for going up the inside. That wasn't really the best of ideas, to be honest. He went in at such a speed. But, wow, what an end to the race. It's still with 3 minutes to go. And it's such an unfortunate event there for Mortensen, but I think that could be race over for him. But Eriksson there, and you can see behind, is Mortensen's teammate.
Eriksson, the independent, it's Jose Mora in the car. I think he's jumped Mortensen, although it looks like Mortensen is currently now in 6th place, so he lost 3 positions because of that incident. So that's put the other Atlantic Racing Team driver, Jose Mora, up into 5th. Andreas Eriksson is in 4th. And these two are going to go at it again. Please, Andreas, just focus on getting a good run out the last corner. Every time he's been close, he's gone too deep into the final corner. He's struggled to get the run. Turn one is the best spot. And once again, he's not close enough to do a proper move. Let's see what he can do. Experienced man, as we said, won Daytona last week in the Car Factor 98 series. Biting now as we've got just under 2 minutes to go of this 1 hour, 30-minute race. Fighting non-stop through this race, we've been treated. He's going for the inside. No contact, please. Looks like they're going side by side. Andreas has got the job done. A bit of contact. A lot cleaner than what we saw last lap.
The inside, and Dahlgren's holding it right there. Dahlgren in the wall. So Oh, it's 10 to 1 minute 33 seconds left. And I think Ericsson's finally got the position, but Dalgren realises what's at stake here. But if I was saying, no, I'd just ease off and let it go. Oh, he's a big, that's a spin. And I just said, let it go, just take fourth position. And as a result of that, he's down to fifth. But you could say it's a bit of karma what happened to Mortensen. So it's all unfolding here in the final 5 minutes. This has been fantastic in some ways, but disastrous in others.
Yep, so Andreas Ericsson, who suffered earlier, has come off with a result here as he's now got the clean track. He's won the battle. His car has stayed in a straight line, whereas the other two have experienced issues, not necessarily to their own fault, especially with Kasper. Maybe that's, as you said, karma for both Kasper and Magnus. Though Andreas should have this third spot wrapped up, although Jose Moore is only 2.6 seconds behind and closing in. This is going to be a big ask with 35 seconds to go. Let's take a look at our race leader, who's pretty much had it all to himself since Mohamed crashed out of the lead after his pedals packed up. It's going to be a great start to the season. Is there going to be another lap here? Trying to work out where we are on the circuit. I believe this will be. They are on the last lap. But Peter Enders just needs to keep it on the black stuff and drive it to the line, and he will take the win at the opening round of the FLMC 2012 Championship at Sim Racing Online. Second place, Luke Walsh, excellent drive. Third place, Andreas Ericsson.
Luke Walsh, is, you know, there's been plenty of spills during this race. There's been crashes and spins all through. It's an hour and a half, and it's been quite a lengthy one, but Luke Walsh seems to have come through it unscathed. I think that's a very well-deserved second position, if not driver of the day.
Yep, indeed, as we are watching Andreas Ericsson head up towards the final chicane. Peter Enders falling asleep here. But Peter Enders shouldn't have any issues. I believe that could be Jordan Weeks behind him. A look there, yes it is, in the other Atlantic Racing Team number 2 car. So here we go, up to the final corner. Goes in a bit deep, might be celebrating already, I believe this is. No, we're going to have the final chicane. I'm getting confused with this track, too many 90 degree left and right handers. I'll let you do the honours as he enters the final chicane.
So the whole will be going quite happy now, just bring it home, is what he's going to be saying in his head. This will be the longest 1 minute 50 of his life. And now, so Peter Enders is your winner, as he flashes his lights in joy, and so does his teammate. Very well deserved, Peter Enders is your winner for the first round of the Formula Le Mans Championship, and he has done an exceptional job. We say he knows what it's like to be good under the pressure, and he's proved that today. Luke Walsh comes in second, and he's saying, you know, series admin, he's done a fantastic job to keep his nose clear of trouble. Third place man is going to be Ericsson again, well deserved after what happened earlier. There'll be Mora comes home in four. The rookie Dahlgren, after keeping his nose out of trouble most of the race and some great racing up until the incidents with Mortensen, and I think it was just the pressure at the end of the race, and then Mortensen will bring the car home in fifth position. But what a fantastic race this has been, and what a closure to it.
Yep, excellent driving. Congratulations to all the finishers. Mortensen actually came home in sixth, so Dahlgren was fifth, and Mora was fourth, Ericsson third. I believe that was Anders Ilsen actually came home in, if I can get standings up, I think that was a 7th position for Anders Orchella. Get the standings back up, as I believe all the guys have finished. There you are, there's confirmation on the finishing result. Peter Enders takes the win, Atlantic Racing Team Luke Walsh 2nd, Andreas Ericsson 3rd, Jose Mora 4th, Magnus Dahlgren 5th, Kasper Mortensen 6th, Kjell Stenbeck 7th, Anders Nilsson 8th, Jordan Weeks in 9th, Eddie Halgren in 10th, and David Nichols, the final finisher, comes home in 11th place.
So we're trying to get a few guys for interview, maybe. Let's see if we can find.
Yep, one moment. So here we are, we've been joined by all the drivers after that epic 1 hour 30 minute race. Render sadly isn't here, and Scheller doesn't want to speak to us, so we'll go to the second place man and possibly the driver of the day, Mr. Luke Walsh. Congratulations on an excellent result for you. Describe your race today.
Well, first thing wasn't too promising. I seemed to drop back quite a lot. People were just flying past me. And then second stop came in. Came in for the second stint, and I put in slightly not enough fuel, so the whole of the last stint, I just had to short shift and try and save fuel, which was quite nerve wracking.
Well, it's very impressive when you consider you seem to keep your car out of the water today. We saw you having a really nice side by side battle with Kasper Mortensen in the first half of the race, but yeah, excellent to be able to fuel save and still finish in second place with a decent gap back to third. It's an excellent drive. Congratulations. Do you believe we have the third place man, Andreas Eriksson, winner of the Kart Factor Daytona race last weekend? Andreas, eventful race today. We saw you in the wars with Kasper. I believe he gave you a bit of hit in the first half of the race, and you had a pretty feisty battle with Magnus and Kasper again towards the end, but you coming off better off and taking third place. Describe your race to us today.
Yeah, it was quite eventful. I didn't think I would be able to get on the podium. Wasn't on the pace at all. Qualified 10th, I think. then I left Dahlgren 2, a bit too easy in the beginning. And then got stuck behind him. Then got pumped off by Mortensen. So maybe, and I thought that was it, and then I had some equipment problems, the wheel wanted to put me in neutral, and that's not good when you downshift, because then you get into reverse, so lost a few more seconds there, but it's amazing that I don't know how I got back. I don't know what's happened to our guys, the race is over.
Obviously towards the end of the race there was plenty of action, especially in the final 5 minutes, so what was your view on the move between your second place and Mortensen and Dahlgren?
I didn't see it, so I was too focused on controlling the car, to be honest, at that moment. So.
Were you a little bit surprised to see Mortensen's spinning? rolling, doing car wheels.
Oh yeah, that one. Okay, yeah, that was a bit weird. I was thinking of another thing. Yeah, I think they were just banging wheels too much there.
Yeah, definitely looked a bit too feisty at the end. It'd be interesting to see if there are any reports filed at the end of the race. But I believe we've spoken to everyone.
We got Anders Nilsson.
Sorry. Apologies, my favourite weed.
Anders, again, just describe your race to us today. How did that go for you?
It started pretty good and was taking it a bit careful with the tires and so, and Magnus was catching me, so up at the pace a bit, and I was getting a gap to him, and I was catching Mohammed and Anders, and I lost concentration for just a tiny of a second, and the car went into the wall, and I lost the front end. So I had to do a pit stop. It took me 52 seconds to repair the damage, and the car wasn't fast after that. Struggling to get into 51s in the last stint, so
yeah, the end was good. We were wondering what happened to you, because you were in third place, doing a pretty good job, and then we weren't sure if you pitted early or if you did have an issue, so it's good that we've clarified that there. We are also be lucky, the race winner, I believe, has joined us, Mr. Peter Schenders, the man that suffered heartache last weekend with his engine going in the last few minutes of the Daytona race, but here he is, so we get to chat with him today. Congratulations on the win. Describe what you thought, or your feelings, when you saw Mohammed Patel in the wall and then into gravel.
Oh, first of all, good evening, everybody. Yeah, what a tough race. I'm so exhausted. I hadn't any time to breathe for the first hour. It was so close. The cars are so close, I want to say. I mean, it was only a gap of half a second, and tough race. And yeah, And I saw Mohamed got some problem with his brakes or something. He was braking all the time. I don't know if he run not enough braking cooler, you know, or what happens. I don't know. But yeah, on the one side I was it was okay. But on the other side I knew the race was over. So I want to have a shout out to him. Great race, great driving. It was really fun. Little bit too close for me sometimes. And yeah, I had to recover one spin where he touched me on the left rear, but he just was so kindly to let me pass, and we just gone on.
Yep, we and did see that driving. On the broadcast. That was nice of Mohamed to allow you the position back. But I believe, yeah, congratulations on the win. Great drive. You stayed out of trouble. One of the few people that did, you and Luke today, so. It was a tough competition between driver of the day, but I think Luke just edged it because he definitely made up quite a lot of spots, but you were very much close to being the driver of the day, but an excellent start to the championship for you, with a lot of your main rivals with issues, but I guess there's not much more to do, but go on then.
I also think that, you know, you couldn't say now for the next round this guy will win. There are so many guys on the same level, as I mentioned, Casper or Jose. I mean, every one of them, or Mohamed or also Luke, every one of them could have won. I mean, it was just a factor of luck, I think, a little bit.
I predicted it at the start that I said that because of the slipstream and the closeness between the drivers that there would just be a train, and at the start it was the three or four of you all fighting for the lead. It was
There is no slipstream, I have to say.
Oh, well, it looked like we were watching a few drivers and who were running lower wings, and they were getting some big drafts. They would get a good run out the final corner, and down into turn one they would get the job done.
I guess it would. It would be good slipstream if you got a very good exit, but if the driver in front had an equal exit, it would be very, very hard to overtake.
So maybe we've been talking nonsense then for the last hour and a half. It was exciting.
You can say that.
I think it's really important to get a real good exit and a good entry of the corner. Slipstream or this car's got no power. I mean, you want to go and this car, you know, doesn't go forward. So the exit, I think the line of the car is the important stuff here.
Yeah. Well, I'd just like to say thank you to everyone. I'm going to hand over to Liam Jenkins, who will do the honours of closing off this broadcast. Thanks everyone for joining us, and over to you, Liam.
Yeah, well,
thank you.
It's been a fantastic round one here of the Formula Le Mans Championship, and it's been a pleasure to commentate, and hopefully I'll be here for round two of the championship. So congratulations to Peter, and thanks to George for joining me in the commentary box. So until next time, guys, have a great week, and I hope you've enjoyed watching it.